shadows come. Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, and I know he watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches.
I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
He watches me.
His eye. And I know he watches.
I know he watches.
I know he watches me.
I
sing because I'm happy. I sing.
Welcome to the Delaware Art Museum this morning. As we come together to do a few things, we are here to remember Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski. It's a big name. I have come to learn that there are some people for whom three names is not enough. They are, their personality is, the life they live is simply too big to be captured in three names. So, this morning, we are here for Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski. And here this morning, we will celebrate Joseph. We will celebrate his life. In the past couple of weeks, I have heard so many stories about Joseph and have learned what a full and rich life he lived. However, too short his life was. But we will celebrate his life together, and we will also grieve. We will grieve his dying. We will grieve that he is no longer with us. We grieve that he will no more come walking into Pagave, that we will see him and Paul together around town. And in grieving, we will acknowledge that there is a hole in our hearts and a hole in our lives, a hole in our families. And we will remember Joseph. And remember is a powerful word, because the word literally does not mean simply to recall. To be remembered is to be put back together. To be remembered. And I think that we will find this morning here, as we hear the readings and hear Allison and Father Bill and Paul speak about Joseph, as we hear the wonderful music that will be performed for us this morning, for a moment, Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski will be remembered among us. And lastly, as we celebrate Joseph, as we grieve his dying, we will also acknowledge the gift of Joseph, the gift that all who knew him and all who loved him will carry in our hearts for the rest of our lives. For that is the impression, the impact, clearly, that Joseph had. And so we will name the gift, the wonderful, wonderful, wonderful gift of Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski. Begin this morning, I'd like to invite you to pray with me. We pray, O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day Joseph. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your child, Joseph. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a son of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Rest eternal grant to Joseph, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. like to invite Joseph's nephew Nick and niece Peyton for the readings.
But now, says the Lord, the one who has created you, the one who has formed you, do not fear. For I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. But when you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. You are precious in my sight and honored. I love you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, make me a channel of thy peace. That where there is hatred, I may bring love. That where there is wrong, I may bring the spirit of forgiveness. That where there is discord, I may bring harmony. That where there is error, I may bring truth. That where there is doubt, I may bring faith. That where there is despair, I may bring hope. That where there are shadows, I may bring light. That where there is sadness, I may bring joy. Lord, grant that I may seek rather than to comfort than be comforted, to understand rather than be understood, to love rather than be loved. For it is by self-forgetting that one finds. It is by forgiving that one is forgiven. It is by dying that one awakens to eternal life.
Amen.
I might have known if God had granted me a son. The summer's die one by one, how soon they fly, on and on. And I am old and will be gone. Peace.
Father Bill, very grateful, recovering alcoholic. I never wanted this day to come, but reality came, and we are here. How do you measure the life of a man? It's very difficult, but normally for the things that we have done. I met Joseph about a year and a half ago on April the 15th, 2015, when I moved from Karen down to there. I was met by his wife and him. They helped me to unload, unpack, and to set up the house. And they were very, very good. This is the one that deserves an awful lot of applause and credit. He was the heart of Joseph. And I love that in the eulogy. Somewhere in the eulogy where you said, and we came to realize.
I didn't say it yet. I'm going to say it in a little while, so don't tell him any news. I didn't give the eulogy yet, so don't tell him any secrets. I didn't say it yet. Nobody heard.
Are you going to read it to them?
I am. In a little. But not until later.
Okay, bug him to read you the eulogy.
I'm gonna read it. I'm gonna read it up here in about 10 minutes.
Okay, good. But there was one line in there that I loved. I can't help it, I loved it. Where he said, we knew that we were going to be together for life. We were going to talk about the two of us, not me and not you, Joseph, but us, you, us. And that's exactly how they lived their life. Paul's whole life during the last 2.5 years surrounded Joseph. Nothing Joseph wanted or did or needed would be deprived. Paul made it happen. Now, I love this guy dearly because again, too, I've been hospitalized for about 1.5 years with a fall on the ice that hit the head. I'm not saying head trauma is bad, but he was there for me. I'll never forget. Is there a chair handy? Just put a chair handy here because I just want to sit down.
A chair?
Like the back is still.
I got this one right here.
Back is still a little bit weak. I may need to sit down, but we won't do that.
There you are, right behind your father.
Here.
Okay, good. I want to say a special word of thanks to his family. Is he Paul? Father here?
I'm going to be your mic stand.
There you go. God bless you. Thank God we got a mic that works, huh?
Oh.
So we
can see. Yes. Of course.
I see Joseph's family up here, too, which I have grown to love. You know, how can you expand on this theme that Joseph was about loving and being loved? And that's what his life was all about to Joseph. I got a kick out of the back description of Joseph as a child, a rebellious child. I'm saying bull crap. He was a badass kid. But I love badass kids. They're teachable and whatnot. And the Lord's all fit to put him back into the Navy to get some discipline. See, and he turned out pretty doggone good. But the things I remember about Joseph, too, were the things that it's very hard to put into words. I knew this was coming when Paul said to me that the chemo's not working anymore, nothing's working, I said to Paul, is this the beginning of the end? He shook, he said, yes. And I said a prayer. And Joseph got through it. Joseph got through that. But along the way, so many good things happened that I began to see the programs, the people that they had surrounded themselves with were awesome people who were giving, just like themselves, expecting nothing in return, as in that the definition of love, giving without expecting anything in return. And it was unbelievable to watch what was going on. And I'll never forget, in the emergency room on the Wednesday he died, to watch that place fill up with their friends, the people who love them, began to show up, they knew, to support Joseph and to support Paul and all of his friends. I know I needed that support. It's absolutely amazing to see that happen. I need to say a special word of thanks, too, to the people from the Early Risers Club meeting. They were absolutely phenomenal there. And to watch that thing continue on, as it was pretty obvious that Joseph wasn't going to make it, the crowd grew and the prayers grew. And one of the best moments of my life was being able to give Joseph the last rites in front of all the people that he loved and who loved him. It was absolutely phenomenal to watch that 12-step group come to the aid of Joseph and Paul and all of his friends. The other thing that hit me very close was it was pretty obvious that Joseph wasn't going to make it. Paul had the intuition to go over to him, grab his both hands, and tell Joseph that he loved him and thanked him for 28 years of love. And that was a touching moment, because that was what it was all about. To love and be loved is what life is all about. And so again, Paul responded then, and then when he went back to the house, and again, I had asked some of the people, the medical people, how long did he have? And I said, I had heard it was only just a few minutes. They said, no. Paul had the intuition to know that Joseph's time was here, and went over and took his hands and loved him and kissed him and told him he loved him. You know, how do you put into words this type of love? You've got to see it. You've got to experience it. But again, that says an awful lot about Joseph and Paul. To love and be loved, his life was all about. And when, again, Joseph passed, Paul could go over and wipe his tears away, tell him he loved him, and say goodbye to him. And I know Paul had often mentioned he was afraid he couldn't say goodbye. But he did. But he did. And whatnot. It was so beautiful to see. And all I could see around was the love from the 12-step groups. And I need to say this too. The gay and lesbian community was awesome. They were there for them. Absolutely awesome. And I was working with the gay community since 1952 with the AIDS thing. And I saw how tough it was for them to say goodbye. I learned an awful lot from ministering to and loving and caring for the people who had nobody else to take care of them. So again, I'm going to shut up right now And if we can turn this over, I don't know who the next speaker will be. But again, I would like to turn this thing over to the next speaker.
There was there in Father Bill's remarks a second gift. If you may not have known that you're going to come today and be given the secret to the meaning of life, but Father Bill just articulated it well, to love and to be loved. This is life. Thank you, Father Bill. Now I'd like to invite Joseph's niece, Allison, to make a few remarks.
So obviously Uncle Joe, I'm sure, wanted some comic relief, so I think that's how I got nominated to stand up here. And I have my sister here in case, you know, I cry. So please don't mind also if I keep my eyes down this entire speech. For anyone who was at Uncle Joe and Uncle Paul's wedding, you all know I'm a huge crybaby in public settings, so I know it's really funny thinking back. Perfect. So Uncle Joe, or JoJo, since apparently Uncle Joe made him feel old, is one of the most unique and amazing people in the entire world. Not only is he my uncle and godfather, but he's also my best friend. His passion for life, spontaneity, and family, blood or chosen, are absolutely contagious that you can't help yourself but smile when you are around him. The countless dinner parties he and Paul would host or catch-up sessions in the salon are all testimonies of how much he cared about each and every one of us. I also want to take a second to thank everyone at the salon for becoming family. I've loved all of our ex-boyfriend pep talks and chats and chats about your lives and your kids and how you've been there for my family as well. And I know how much you mean to Uncle Joe and Uncle Paul. Growing up with Uncle Joe and Uncle Paul has been a treat. The way they perfectly complement each other at every Thanksgiving and Christmas dinner, and support each other while hosting every Mother's Day, Father's Day, Easter dinner, and more importantly, any major life event, I will always admire. Maybe it's a Jaworski Van Loo thing, since I always see these traits in my grandparents and the Van Loos. They've also been madly in love since day one. I remember last Christmas when Joe, Paul, and I were sitting around their house catching up, and I said, you know, I don't have a single memory of Uncle Joe without Uncle Paul in it. And Uncle Joe looked at me, he was like, I met him before you were born, so I hope not. Uncle Joe then proceeded to tell me how they met and that I was at the exact same spot that night before while I was visiting a friend in Philly. And man, did I feel special hearing that story. I'm sure everyone has spent a ton of time with Uncle Joe after his diagnosis to see him fight like hell and stay positive, but I also want to remember all the stories that shaped our relationships with him prior. For example, Uncle Joe and I have been through some serious fashion trends together. There was when I wanted highlights and I ended up looking like a skunk. Or when Uncle Joe tried to curl my hair instead of straightening it, and I looked like I had a bush on the top of my head. You remember that, Mom? And there was also when Uncle Joe decided to have frosted tips and white hair, and he looked like Guy Fieri, but you couldn't tell him that because he didn't want to be associated. And then there was also the checklist of ways that Uncle Joe and I tried to push my mom's buttons. I'm sorry, Mom. This included an impromptu field trip to Philly where I got my nose pierced and he got his lip pierced. And I believe my mom referred to us as little shits after. Then there was Christmas when we decided to play Cards Against Humanity as a family. Who knew my dad, Pup-Up, and Mama would win dirtiest card over Uncle Joe? There's also the elf scene we reenacted in Boston visiting Peyton, but we can talk about that later. The list of stories is never ending. I was always laughing when I was around Uncle Joe. He was such a lively person that I would love to hear all of your funny stories after this. I mentioned earlier that Uncle Joe is one of my best friends. I know he has many best friends, but I also know that two of them are my grandparents. As a way of coping, we all joked that Mum-Mum couldn't leave without Uncle Joe. And if you know Pup-Pup, well, you know he sure wouldn't leave without both of them. As much as all of us currently and will continue to miss Uncle Joe, I know he is safe with them and cancer-free on a beach somewhere. Rest in peace, Uncle Joe. I love you forever. Thank you.
Remember the love.
now Paul.
I'm gonna attach this to this stand here. If you were wondering where they came from, the people from the salon made everybody tie-dyed scarves because Joseph loved tie-dye. And he insisted that we do tie-dye on vacation every year for many years. We got a little tired of it, but we kept doing it because he had all the supplies. So, man, he was a guy. Can I have some of those? I'm going to keep his face next to me because I might have a little bit of trouble getting through this all the way, but I'm going to do it. So here we go. Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski. If laughter is the best medicine, then Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski was our cure. If you were to ask me right now, what will I miss the most? It is his impassioned laugh, and reassuring as well. It was also his tender kisses, so sweet. His laugh was infectious. I will always cherish the memory of each time he walked through the door, hearing his boot heels tap on the hardwood floors and the sound of his laugh brightening the room and those in his path. It made my heart skip a beat every time. A wonderful friend said recently, it wasn't exactly what he said or what he did, it was how Joseph made you feel. Joseph was born in Philadelphia on May 21st, 1967. Before moving to Delaware at a very young age, he attended Shortridge Elementary School. The reason I bring it up, you probably ask, on our first trip to Houston to meet a renowned oncologist after Joseph's diagnosis. While picking out our rental car, it turned out that the Enterprise agent had also attended Shortridge Elementary School. What are the chances, you know, right? Joseph asked him, do you remember the song? And, the agent's face lit up with a wide smile. Within minutes, there they were, singing. They stood there in the middle of the parking deck, my beloved husband and the Enterprise agent belting out the Shortridge Elementary alma mater. After it was all over, the man hugged Joseph and wished him the best. It was very touching. It was during these times that I loved my husband even more. He was a man who loved meaningful songs, especially those that came from the performer's toes, those that made your arm hair stand up. It was one of our special little things, like an inside joke that only the two of us know. We would compare goosebumps when we were out someplace. At Glasgow High School, Joseph's only interests were his drama and his singing classes. As far as the rest of his classes, he simply didn't like to be told that he had to do homework. His report card showed the real truth, and let's just say Marge and Ray, they were not at all thrilled. After editing my 10-page handwritten version of this eulogy, my dear friend Kate, who's a professional writer, told me not to use the word rebellious to describe Joseph during that phase of his life. But there really is no better way to say it. I told her he was the epitome of rebellious. Joseph was always grateful that his sister, Tina, never caused any trouble. He created enough for the both of them. On one occasion, when Mom and Dad took away Joseph's Volkswagen Rabbit as a punishment, he wrote a very distinct message to them across the front velour seats of the car to let them know how he really felt. His rebellious and creative side wrote the words in white chalk. That message never truly disappeared. And it became a story to explain to potential buyers years later. He obviously made his point quite clear. Then there was the time Joseph threatened to run away. His mother, Marge, packed him a bag and thinking he wouldn't get too far, ha. He and a friend hitchhiked all the way to Southern Virginia before being picked up by the police. Marge and Ray drove hours to pick him up at the station the next morning, and let's just say it was a painfully silent and long ride back to the house. By his late teens, Joseph was officially bored. He wanted to travel the world, and he was smart enough to realize that he needed some discipline in his life. In comes the Navy. Joseph signed up and served as an airman on the aircraft carrier USS Nimitz, moored off Seattle, Washington. You know, being a 20-year-old gay man on a ship with 6,000 hot men was a pretty good deal. Joseph thought so. I really won't go into too many stories. We can talk later. During these years, Joseph traveled the world, Egypt, Turkey, France, the Far East. He loved it all. He was so proud to have served his country. Boeing handed him a sweet offer after being discharged, but Joseph, a man who truly cherished his family, returned to Delaware to work side by side with his mom and dad at Wilmington Builders, the family business. He blossomed into an exceptional kitchen and bathroom designer, but moreover grew to love so much working with his mom and dad. Everyone always said Joseph was his dad's mini-me, a comparison he never really got tired of hearing. So everyone wants to know, how did we meet? Well, it was on June 7th, 1991. It was an especially hot and muggy day in Center City, Philadelphia, at a bar called Woody's on 13th Street. Joseph, in true form, was wearing jeans and a long-sleeved t-shirt, a black leather Harley-Davidson motorcycle jacket, and black cowboy boots. Not what you'd expect him to wear in the summer, right? Not Joseph. In fact, his cousins later told me that he was known for doing that, because on the flip side, you could find him wearing a tank top and shorts during a blizzard and complaining about how cold it was. Back in that day, Joseph sported quite a mullet. It truly was his favorite haircut of all times. And honestly, he could carry it off. I mean, damn, he was so handsome. Just such a hottie. That first night was magic. On our second date, I knew I was in love with this man. After 6 months of living at my apartment in Philly during the week and commuting to Ellesmere on weekends, Joseph asked me to move in. I was ecstatic and carted everything down to his townhouse in the next month. We were quite a vision. Joseph with his pregnant cocker spaniel, Shayna, and me with my four cats, Weenie, Rudy, Woody, and Spike. We somehow lived in harmony. It was my dream. Coming home every day to my soulmate who I'd spend the rest of my life with. In May of 1995, we moved into our dream house, Oak Springs. It was a 750 square foot, charming old cottage on a beautiful piece of property in North Wilmington. I was a nervous wreck. On our first night, our first home, my first mortgage, which was the nerves. On our first night, Joseph lured me out to a far, dark corner of the yard. And under two huge burning bushes, I saw a sign. The sign read, "Welcome home into our future. I will love you forever." I walked past the sign, and behind it, Joseph had created a makeshift lean-to out of a vinyl tablecloth. Surprise, surprise. Underneath it were two beach chairs, a small table, a vase with a rose, a card, and a bottle of champagne. There we sat and listened to the rain and toasted each other and talked about our future. I want to always remember the way that Joseph made me feel so safe. He was the one person that I felt most secure with. Yet at the same time, he inspired me to take risks. Over the next 15 years, he influenced me to do many things that I would have never done without him. I remember one day, Joseph and I set out to buy an investment property. So I was thinking small house, maybe a condo, easy rental. Nope, Joseph had something else in mind. By the day's end, we were the proud owners of a 5-unit Victorian apartment house in Trolley Square. It was in shambles. It was a mess. Joseph didn't see that. He had a vision. And he was right. Today, the apartment house is completely renovated and beautiful, and it's full of awesome friends who love living there. A few years later, happened again. Still averse to taking risks, I was again encouraged to make a leap of faith, which included business ownership, long-term debt, short-term stress, being an employer, and tackling the colossal job of managing a full staff. You all know that venture now as Bagave Salon and Spa. We now had yet another loving family, and Bagave is thriving. Yes, I took a risk, and guess what? I was not only safe, but flourishing into a life I could never have imagined. On September 8th, 2012, after a 21-year engagement, Joseph and I got married, along with 200 family members and friends. We played our favorite song. It's called Sunlight and Moon. In hindsight, the lyrics so perfectly embodied us. I'll quote from the song. Joined by the gods of fortune, sharing the sky, we have been blessed, you and I. How in the light of one night did we come so far? It was the happiest day of our life together. A few years later, my life began to unravel, as well as his, completely and quickly, all due to my addiction to alcohol. Joseph knew it, well before I was willing to admit. Once again, he came to the rescue. His gentle ultimatum was the catalyst that got me off the floor and into rehab. We drove all the way to Miremont Treatment Center in silent tears. The reassurance I felt from his strong hand, his holding mine so tight, it was a reminder of that sense of safety again. I did not want to let go as we hugged goodbye in the waiting room. In that moment, I was terrified that the love and respect he had for me would all vanish. However, we emerged from those dark days anew, again, an unstoppable team. After his dad passed and Wilmington Builders closed, Joseph decided he'd go back and finish cosmetology school, get his license, and set up own shop inside Bagave. His plan was to offer barbering, skincare, and waxing for the boys. We practically peed ourselves coming up with the copy for the intro cards. Could you imagine? Bagave Salon introduces Joseph for all of your manscaping needs. And for the areas that needed waxing, would backs, cracks, and sacks be too forward? Huh. We almost did it. I got sober. Joseph was so unbelievably supportive in all ways, and he himself soaked up the 12-step program like a giant sponge. He worked the recovery principles in his way. He accompanied me to many meetings, right there by my side as a loyal, committed husband. His favorite fellowship was a prayer and meditation meeting on Sunday mornings. Being spiritual from the start, Joseph's relationship with a power greater than himself grew. The God of his understanding gave him the courage, resilience, and strength he would need to battle the terminal cancer diagnosis we received on May 18th, 2017. Okay, this is the hard part. He fought so hard for what felt like an eternity, but it was only 15 short, brutal months. Joseph refused to give up. He never lost hope until that last day. Despite knowing that the end was near, I remember the last weekend we spent together. We received word that the immunotherapy was no longer working. Joseph and I sat together on the couch and talked about the only thing left were clinical trials. I'll never forget, fighter to the end, he looked straight at me and blurted out, "Well, Paul, I have to do something." He's a fighter. We then put our heads together to find a clinical trial that would treat his cancer. But before we got to embarking on the research, Joseph's lung collapsed early morning, and we headed straight to Wilmington Hospital. That was Monday. I was blessed to be surrounded by so many friends. Within hours, a team of angels masquerading as healthcare providers swooped in. Hospice descended on us, and I told the lead nurse that our primary wish was for Joseph to die at home. They got it done. Within hours, Joseph was safe in the house we cherish, wearing a Superman t-shirt. And I, sitting by his side, was all too surreal. Just 10 minutes before leaving this earth, God gave me the opportunity to tell him what had always been in my heart. I was so afraid for so long. That I wouldn't be able to say goodbye. But God provided, and there we were, gazing into each other's eyes in our beautiful home, and I was able to tell him how truly precious he was to me. How I loved him so, and how honored I was to spend half of my life with him. Finally, he squeezed my hand. When I told him how proud I was of his incredible courage and grace that he had shown throughout that excruciating year, I told him how much I would miss his smile and his spirit and our life together. I wiped away his tears and I kissed him goodbye. Moments later, he was gone. For 9,923 days, I had the pleasure and the joy of being one half of us. It was never him, it was never me, it was always us. Today our hearts are broken, they're aching, but over time we will heal. The sadness will be replaced by memories of a man with a huge heart and an unstoppable spirit. He left a handprint on all of our hearts, and we will never be the same. Joseph Raymond Paul Jaworski left his mark on this world by the way that he lived and by those of us that he touched so deeply. To Joseph, I would say, until we meet again, my love, sleep with the angels, sweetheart. I will love you forever. Thank you.
Oh.
immediate family would please stay seated. Will the congregation please stand as you're able for the presentation of the flag?
Like a seed dropped by a sky bird in a distant wood. Who can say if I've been changed for the better? But because I knew you,
because I knew you,
I have been changed for good. And just to clear the air, forgiveness for the things I've done, you blame me for.
But then I guess we know there's blame to share,
and none of it seems to matter anymore.
Like a ship borrowed from its moorings
by a wind off the sea.
Yeah.
Our service is ending. Our celebration continues. At the conclusion of this service for Joseph, everyone here is invited to Paul and Joseph's home for a reception. The address is printed in your bulletin. At the very end of the service, Paul and his family are going to process out and go straight home. And there is where they will be happy to greet you and talk with you. For our final prayer and benediction, I invite you, as you are able, to please stand. Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember this day before you, your child Joseph, and we pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you will receive him into your joyful presence. We seem to give him back to you, dear God, who gave him to us. Yet as you did not lose him in giving, so we have not lost him by his return. You do not give as the world gives, O lover of souls. For what you give, you take not away. For what is yours is ours always, if we are yours. And life is eternal, and love is immortal, and death is only a horizon, and a horizon is nothing save the limit of our sight. Lift us up, Almighty God, that we may see further. Cleanse our eyes, that we may see more clearly. Draw us closer to yourself, that we may know ourselves nearer to our beloved, who are with you. And while you prepare a place for us, prepare us for that place, that where they are and you are, we too may be. In your most holy name we pray. Amen. Printed in the bulletin is the Serenity Prayer, a prayer dear to Paul and Joseph. This is going to test our community skills. We invite you to hold hands and read from the bulletin at the same time. So if that requires linking arms, touching elbows, just so that we know ourselves joined to one another. This is a fabulous video. Oh, it's on the screen behind me. Oh. There you go. If you would just turn the lights down a little bit, let me step out of the way. Let us pray together. God, give me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Thy will be done. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and the blessing of Almighty God be upon you and remain with you this day and every day. Amen.